too much this.
Well, I don't know. What do you mean? I don't know who this is. Is this on? Okay. Welcome back.
Hello?
Okay. Welcome back, everyone. We're to the supply chain workshop part. It's good to see that in one hand, the room isn't as full as we were anticipating, because we were told there were going to be 130 of you. So we're happy that it isn't going to be quite as unmanageable as all of that. Yes? In looking at this, we've initially yesterday over a couple of beers thought that we were somehow blessed because the problem statement that we have and which we're hoping to find solutions to over these next 2 days is quite a simple one. Ultimately, what we're talking about is at whichever level, whether it's in the communities, whether it's in the health center or the school, that the person the supplies are designed for and are intended for, when they reach behind them to take a pharmaceutical product off the shelf, that item should be there. So for us, it's really about first of all, ensuring the availability of the product, that it has to be there at the right time. And from that, our problem is basically housed in two areas. One is using technology and some of the ideas we bring up over these 2 days to improve our efficiency, which is, you know, getting the product to the end user in the most efficient way possible. And then secondly, once we've done that, to ensure that actually it's the right product going to the right people. And at the right time. So that's in terms of our effectiveness measure. So really we thought that the problem solution is quite simple. However, on second thoughts this morning, I just have a slide to show you as an illustration. It is a simple problem that we face. The trouble is there's a lot of people trying to address the same simple problem. This is a slide that's done by a fellow called Steve Kinzit for JSI. And that is his map of the health supply system in Kenya. And what's interesting about it, if you think of all the different products that people are interested in tracking and all the different organizations supplying those products, they're all having their own requirements for reporting. So if it's for antiretrovirals, there'll be people investing money because they have a certain reporting format. If UNICEF come in for bed nets, we might have a specific reporting format, as would USAID. The problem is that all these data demands, ultimately, at the end of the day, are coming down onto what's put here as district-level staff. And yesterday we had a presentation about a reality check in terms of the environment we're dealing with. And you're basically looking at a reporting requirement that's all being put onto the shoulders of these people here. And these people, who are they? Well, they're working in district medical stores, or they're working in district education departments. You can assume that if they have a computer and an Excel spreadsheet, that they're lucky. In many cases, they'll be lucky to have a typewriter. They'll be probably underpaid. Salaries will come late, if at all. It's dusty, it's hot, and sometimes there's no electricity. And yet, on their shoulders is this entire requirement. So that's hopefully what looking at in terms of some of the applications of this technology we've been talking about. There is the reality check in that the data demands being put on these very few people are quite onerous. So just to go through a little bit with what we'll do over the next sort of 2 hours, I have a colleague here, Mahfoud Buhembel.
Sure.
Nice. Mahfood is listed here as working for WFP, which he doesn't actually do. He was seconded to WFP to the logistics cluster in Rome for a period of 2 years. And to reward him, we brought him back to Copenhagen in the middle of winter, for which he's going to, I hope, be eternally grateful. He's just briefly going to go in a little bit more detail in terms of efficiency and effectiveness, what we're after in terms of solutions, and describe a bit our operating context. Don't let that put you off. It's quite simple. Second, we have Simon, from a researcher from MIT Logistics Center in Zaragoza. He's doing a project for us, basically trying to make sense of all this technology, particularly started off in the SMS field, but not limited to that. And he's been doing a bit of desk research on some of these applications and how they're being used, and want to determine the applicability for our operations, for supply operations in general. And so some of the end product of the breakouts will be collated by him, and we'll push forward to try and create one or two pilots later on in the year. And third, we have Jonathan Jackson from Dimagi, who will demonstrate a gizmo called an Android, which is the first time I ever heard of that. That's not in the context of Terminator movies or something like that. Just to demonstrate that UNICEF did do one or two pilots using this kind of technology. And then we'll go for refreshments, and we'll start the breakout work.
Okay, I'll start by a couple of slides. It's much simpler than what Paul have just showed. So I'll start by a couple of visuals to illustrate what Paul explained yesterday, and also a little bit today, about the last mile of the supply chain that tend to get lost in translation. Along the chain, there are multiple actors that intervene. This is adding to the challenge of connectivity and feedback at the very decentralized level for getting accurate information on what have been distributed, where, when, and to whom. Basically, it may not help answering the question, are we doing the things right vis-a-vis our plans? Another important question is, are we doing the right things? Although most organizations are also, and also some governments, have developed their IT system, there still remain an issue of knowing what happens to goods after they leave one stakeholder's oversight. In UNICEF, we have seen some ideas and developments the Division of Communication has been looking into that may prove to be a solution for the last mile visibility, and eventually linking monitoring and evaluation with assessment and planning. This slide is just to show that when there are perceived problems on delays in the supply chain, there may be a tendency to overorder as a hedge against this very perception. And that this behavior actually helps create some of those delays, a vicious circle, in other words. When the information along the pipeline is lacking or insufficient, reordering requirements are also faulty then. Wrong information in the whole logistics network contributes to a less than optimal supply chain response. This slide is a portion of a work done by Duke University on ready-to-use therapeutic food. So to sum up so far, we could retain a few keywords: trust among partners in the supply chain, collaboration between those partners, technology as an enabler to cover the whole supply chain in an environment where connectivity and also exposure to technology is, say, a challenge, to be simple. Okay, I talked about information and supply chain data. In isolation, they help. Combined with other programming activities and indicators information, they make sense by linking the different inputs and outputs. But analyzing them and making the results visible in a non-traditional way, meaning words, graphs, and tables, can be very powerful. Here, I'm going to just show you a simple, basic, archaic map, but simple things show sometimes a lot. So infrastructure, road infrastructure, population, health centers in the country, just that shows something, maybe some gaps, access to health facilities. But what if we could enable, for instance, health workers to regularly communicate on health activities as well as on supply consumption or cold chain breakdown or whatever, directly to higher levels? This would be a breakthrough in quality monitoring, evaluation, and assessment too. So if we combine, for instance, static data, semi-static data, very highly dynamic data from the most decentralized level in a visual way, well, I think it can tell us a lot. Basically, with adapted, robust, and sustainable technology as an enabler, again, for better supply chain visibility and collaboration, we could also, and more quickly, correlate supply outputs, outcomes, impacts to program strategies, outputs, outcomes, and impact, linking, for instance, I don't know, mortality rate related to malaria with availability, but also use of bed nets, for instance, or other products, and whether they are fit for the purpose. Thank you.
It's not that. Okay. So thank you for inviting me to this conference. We have been commissioned by UNICEF Supply Division to do an assessment of what technologies are out there that can be used to strengthen the supply chain. So first, let's look at what we meant by a supply chain. This is a very simplified sketch that comprises all operations since procurement order to the end-user reception of the goods. We will be focusing in three areas. The first one is track and trace, which comprises all of these operations. Second will be end-use monitoring, which is just something that is not been done, and we would like to use to feedback to the moment of procurement and procure the goods that exactly are needed. And last one is emergency response, which is the most general of all and comprise most operations. It's important to bear in mind the slide that was shown by Paul at the beginning, in which there are many different organizations involved in this process. So it's not a simple manner to coordinate all of them and to give the data to all of them. So here is a set of questions that should be kept in mind when designing an intervention in which we hope we will strengthen the supply chain by using mobile technologies. So first of all is to keep in mind who has the information. Is it the health worker? It is the end user? It is the logistician? And secondly is, do we have a communication channel open today? How effective it is? This is very important. Maybe we are receiving reports by paper during a week, and we are only sending supplies in a month time. So this is enough time for us to reply. So should we employ the resources to make it faster? Maybe it's not what we should do. Third is to think about what are the motivations or the incentive for the people who hold the information to share them with us. If they are motivated themselves, it's just a matter of facilitating a channel. If they are not, we can think about doing incentives. But this is a double-edged sword, because maybe we are promoting false reporting. So it's also something that we have to take into account. Fourth is to thinking about constraints. But budget constraint is obvious, but then we have also technological constraint, there is connectivity, whatever, and then is the cultural constraint. There are some countries in Africa in which the women are not allowed to have a cellular phone because the husband thinks they will use it to cheat on them. So depending on who holds information and who we want to talk to, this is also that has to be considered country by country. And finally, but not least, is how all this information will be processed and shared with all the stakeholders. Keep in mind this slide of the supply chain in Kenya. So first, let's concentrate in track and trace. This is like the bread and butter of supply chains. And these are a set of questions that we have to be answering to design an implementation. First is, do the health clinic has connectivity? If they have connectivity, they can either report by voice or they can send data. This data can be acquired just by a barcode link with a GPS or other devices that tell us where these units have arrived. Or we can use SMS templates in the manner of some interventions that have been explained in this arena. If there is no connectivity, we can either consider to give them satellite connectivity or just use a synchronous mode, which is offline. We record the data, we store this in our device, and then whenever we have connectivity, we send it. Talking about devices, we have been talking about mobile phones. They are ubiquitous in Africa. They are very present. They are low cost. End users have them. However, if we have the choice, maybe we should consider to use something as a PDA of a smartphone because they can be procured in a manner that fits better our need, more rugged, is have a special customized function like GPS and other facilities. So I'm going to talk about just one example in each of these categories. This example is for track and trace. It was done by an NGO called JOBSA, and they are targeting health information in rural setting. So what a rural setting means here is that people live days of travel for the health clinics. So there are community workers that travel around, they have their own routes, and they are going checking what the current patients are doing with the dosage, and are they sticking to the program and so on, and what new problems are arising in these communities. Before, they were doing this just reporting at the moment that they went back to the headquarters, so that they had to travel with some medications and drugs and try to give people what they needed, but they could only do as good as the information they had in the previous route. What this NGO did is to start an SMS reporting system in which they use 100 donated cellular phones. They give them to the health community workers, and then they started sending the information whenever connectivity was available. This data first was aggregated in terms of who is sending this information, which diseases are more prevalent, and so on. But importantly, this data was linked with the inventory systems so that people at the headquarters would be able to do the procurement in advance and then have enough drugs for the next traveling season. Forecasting is so important in supply chain. This is key to streamline all the operations. And this is something that can be greatly facilitated by these kind of interventions. So let's move to end-use monitoring. When we want to do this type of intervention, the question that we should ask is, first, do these people have connectivity, a channel open with us? Sometimes in the developed world, this is by means of a shared device. If they are not motivated, as I mentioned before, we should think about incentives for them to report. But then we have to be very careful that this reporting is a true reporting and not a false reporting just to get something out of us. If they are motivated, we can use SMS, but SMS is only good if people is literate and they speak English. If it's not, something that it can be done is this interactive voice response that we are so used to when we call our credit card, and then they said, if you want to make a payment, press 1, if you want to do whatever. This is not immediately accessible for them, but it's a lot easier and can be done in the local language. If they have no device, no connectivity, we must do a survey. If we do a survey, if connectivity is available, they can send data immediately. If it's not, they will record the data and send it later. So as an example for end-use monitoring, I'm concentrating in an intervention made by AED, Netmark. Netmark is an NGO that is dedicated to promote the use of bed nets. They do this using funds of USAID. And what they did is to start looking to do market research. They send the surveyors with a PDA, with a template, and then they start asking people, do you use a bed net? If you don't use it, why is that? It's too expensive, it is too hot to sleep underneath, it is just that you don't like the color and you think it's no good in your home. And then they are using this data for the procurement of the bed nets in the future. This is something really important, and it's so little that it has been done in the humanitarian field that we should be concentrating and do a lot more often. Finally, we are going to talk about the new technologies applied to emergency response. Here, there is no decision tree. And there is no decision tree because the situation varies enormously from one situation to another. It is very different an intervention after a natural disaster in which there is no infrastructure and the first thing that has to be implemented is a channel of communication to the man-made disasters in which there is something like what I'm going to present here, a xenophobia crisis, and then infrastructures are there. It's just that they are not open to everyone. So in this case, it's a small NGO called Chauco. They, in a manner similar to what we have seen Ushahidi this morning, they gather information from the crowds, but it's a little different. What they did is they posted in their webpage at the beginning of the xenophobia crisis in South Africa, they posted a standardized assessment of what the communities need because of the migration of people. 33 responses were received in the first 2 days. Another 60 responses were received in the next 4 days. This allowed them to put 9 additional clinics where they were needed to serve the community needs. And this is a very interesting mixture of grassroots and top-down intervention in which the NGO just put what was useful for them, and it was up to the people to use it and report and then do the intervention a success. So last but not least, we have been talking a lot about how to gather data. Then we have to think, what will we do with the data once we have it? This is a nice sketch that I like, in which we have at the right-hand side the real world, and then we have all the process until we go and action again in the left-hand side. So down there we have data, how we gather it, and this is what mostly we have been discussing so far. Then to transform data and information, we have to do analysis. And this is not trivial, for instance, with the Ushahidi example, getting 6,000 SMS make it difficult to discriminate what is real important data and what is not. Once we have this information, we have to link that with our knowledge and with our past experience before designing the new intervention. Let's say that we have successfully done all of these steps. And now we have this information that, again, remember this slide about the Kenya supply chain that we have to share with so many organizations. So first is a matter of making it visually informative. This, along the supply chain, people need different kinds of information. So this has to be customized for every link in the supply. And obviously, because we are here talking about mobile technologies, this has to be made it accessible from a mobile platform. And then we have to integrate all this data with the ERP system of all these organizations so that this is linked with all the other financial and operations that our organization should have to take into account. So thank you very much for your attention, and I will be happy to answer any questions.
Thank you. And that was great information on the various aspects of the supply chain management problem that we're looking at. I want to talk today a bit about an application we built with the UNICEF Innovation Group that is called Rapid Android. The goal of this project was to create an easy-to-deploy, easy-to-use application for one of these end-user SMS applications that Simon referred to. Broadly, as an IT person, I think about an SMS application like this. We need to define the data set we want. We need to collect that data, we need to transform that data into something usable, and then we need to perform some analysis and analyze the data. There's a variety of options today that we can use, and for example, one of Instead's projects will have an SMS gateway that's available in 88 different international countries. Those end users can SMS to that gateway number. That gateway number pushes the SMS to a web server, and us as end clients can hit it through the internet. This is very good for large-scale international deployments, but there's a barrier to entry. You need to partner with local carriers. You need to negotiate very expensive, very high-quantity SMS prices. Another option that a lot of groups have done, and Ushahidi is an example of this, will take a local server, plug in a phone or a GPRS modem, let the local users SMS into that application, and then that local server is hosting the data. And you can either access it directly if you happen to be in the same office as the server, or you can access it through the internet. This is a much lower cost deployment option than the first slide, but has a lot of moving parts. So when we've tried to deploy this in the past, we've broken the cell phone, we've broken the modem, it hasn't been on the internet. So this also has a lot of problems with it. As we've seen in previous things, and one thing that John Gage talked about a bit, is the technology convergence of cell phones and computers. What's been happening for the past 20 years is computers get more and more features like cell phones, and cell phones are getting more and more features like computers. Well, we finally got to the point with the iPod, with the Android phone, even with some Blackberries, that these are so powerful they can now do everything we used to be using PCs for. And the application we're going to show today is an example of doing everything you saw on that map. So all we have here is a rapid Android application running on a phone like this, which is the Google phone that they came out with about 4 months ago. And this is capable of doing the role of all the other moving parts that you saw. So Rapid Android is a complete two-way SMS solution. It's deployable on a single phone, which is important because this really lowers the barrier to entry for people to go try this in the field. It's easily deployable and modifiable. It's free and open source, so anybody can download it. And it came out of a collaboration between the Open Mobile Consortium, which includes members like UNICEF, Instead, Frontline SMS, Ushahidi, everybody working in this space. And this is a very important extra step, but it's by no means the be-all, end-all solution. All of these are very important solutions. This is just one more piece in the ecosystem now. So I'm going to take us through a very quick example of what we would do if we wanted to have a BedNet Distributions supply chain management application running on this phone. So using the application today, we download it. There's nothing going on. We need to create a new form. We want to create a BedNet form. I can click on the application, and I can start to add fields. I type in the field name, and I select the type of field it is. It might be a word. It might be a number. It could be the height of a child if we're doing a WHO growth chart. After I select all of those fields, I now have my form. And this is what Simon was talking about with the semi-structured SMS. So we can go out into the field, and if I'm a BedNet distributor, I can text in my location, the number of BedNets I received today, the number I've given out, and the balance I have remaining. As these messages come in, we then can start to collect them. So we've done the define part of the problem. We've done it all on the Android phone. Now we need to collect the data. This is the really easy part because it's a phone. We just leave it on. So we're done with that problem. Once the data comes in, we need to now parse that data. Because these phones are now so powerful, I can parse this all on the phone. That problem's done. This is the really neat thing. Before Android and iPhone, you really couldn't do this next step on the phone. You really had to get to a computer. we're able to do charts like this directly on the Android phone. So I can now graph the number of messages coming in over time. I can histogram the locations of those messages. And I can do SQL-like queries of this data. So I can do things not as powerful as SAS or even Access, but fairly powerful stuff that a field worker or a supervisor in the field would want to get access to. I can do it all on the phone. And I can do date boundaries, and I can select the different fields in our form. So, for example, I can look at a histogram or a line chart of the number of bed nets who have been received by individuals in the field over time. This is all on the phone again, and I can look at the balance that each field worker has so I can know when my supply is dropping and I need to get more bed nets out into the field. Finally, the phone won't solve all of our problems. You still need to be able to get the data off the phone. It's a one-click export because Google Android is open source, and so you can get the data off the phone very easily, which is not what the case is with the Apple phones or the Blackberries. And so finally, we're able to do all the cycle of the end user supply chain management problem on the Android phone, with the exception of one thing. You actually have to do something about it when you get the data. And this is definitely not something that the Android phone does any better than the other solutions. That's a human problem, and IT is only going to take us so far. But this is a new, interesting piece of the puzzle because it's so easy to deploy. It's so easy to customize. And anybody can take it out and start to try out different types of forms and different types of applications in the field. And if you want to spam our server, you can text to that phone number, you can text in that, and come find me, and it'll be on my phone when you're done. Thank you very much.
Okay, it says on this paper that we should be breaking for refreshments now. But I think what it might be an idea before doing that, just in terms of the breakout groups for after coffee, it might be just a good idea to already get you into groups before everyone scatters off, and then you can come back and scatter back into those groups. We basically having, again, as Simon said, the four themes, track and trace, end-user monitoring and emergency response as part of the supply chain content, and a fourth one, which is the design in context, which is about the process of designing solutions. What we have in the supply chain for each, whether it's track or trace, end-user monitoring, or emergency response, to try and make it a little bit structured, and again, it was based on the thought that there'd be 150 of you with an hour to discuss this, is that we had suggested three concepts for each of those based on what little we know about the sort of technological solutions that are out there. So what we'd like you to do in the groups is, with these three concepts, is just to go through the pros and cons of each one and to discuss and use that as a springboard for suggesting a concept or concept or two that could be a mix of the three that we've suggested, or it could be something that your discussions take you into anyway and going down interesting paths. Bearing in mind in all of these discussions, and I hope we've sort of highlighted the problem within our operating environment and the context we're trying to deploy this this technology in. Again, referring to yesterday, Nigel had mentioned also a colleague who once asked him, whenever he was talking about technological solutions, is that the person proposing them would have to prove to him why this was better than paper. I think there's evidence, and from what I've seen, certainly yesterday and this morning, I think that evidence is already there, that in terms of what we can do with information that's not paper-based. But just to bear in mind that there is a reality check that should inform the discussions. And then hopefully we'll come back together, and if we're putting them on your pros and cons and any new concept or an expanded version of our concept. Again, we did write these before we came to Web4Dev, so we had actually no idea what you'd all be discussing. We just sort of had our problem that we wanted to articulate for possible solutions. What we'll do after that is Simon and MIT will be collecting the cards. And again, as we said with the breakouts yesterday, we'll try and do short summaries of your discussions for posting up on the UNICEF page or on the Web4Dev page. But then at the same time, we're probably going to take this into further research of your proposed solutions and then look to creating, again, through our project with MIT, one or two pilots to start really testing the applicability of your proposed solutions as a way of improving our supply system. How we'll actually split you all up, I have no idea. After? Why, it's not ready? Oh, okay. Well, it says here refreshments were ready about. Okay, yeah, we can do that. And then afterwards, I think, as far as the groups are concerned, people who are interested in the track and trace stream, it's with Simon. Monitoring and evaluation is with Mahfoud. Emergency responses is with myself. And the designing context is with Deborah there, if Deborah would like to just wave her hand around. And if you can sort of obviously split up kind of evenly so that not everyone is sitting on track and trace and the rest of us are talking to ourselves, that would be useful. I guess if we have the time then, if there's questions from any of you to the panelists who've just presented, then please go ahead.
I just wanted to know, is the Android system available yet?
Yeah, you can order the phone online now, and they'll send you one. You can also buy it in the T-Mobile stores.
No, I mean your software.
Oh, it's actually already been downloaded 200 times since midnight last night when our programmer put it online.
Where is it? It's on the Instead website?
No, if you go to the Android Marketplace.
Oh, it's on their marketplace.
On Google, yeah.
Oh, okay, cool. Thanks.
Jonathan, just a quick question. So the data that comes in through a basic voice and text phone, right? So it's just text, it's just straight text string data. And if you could just talk us through how it like works, you know, for the stepwise from the user side, that would be great.
So the example I was painting was in the case of with Simon's decision tree, where one of the field workers has connectivity and perhaps an end user does not. So my scenario that I presented was around a field worker texting in perhaps once a day how many bed nets they had and how many they have left and what their if they picked up any that day. In that case, a field worker would text in a one-line SMS, and the spaces in the text, in between the text, is what allows the phone to parse the message. So the field worker would simply text in a one-line SMS. If the supervisor or administrator wanted to make a change to that form, they would have to have physical access to the Android phone and then could modify that form, add fields to it, subtract fields to it, and view the historical data. There's a question.
Any others?
Just this information we collect from the field can be transferred as a KML file since it's going to be support by Google. Is it support by Google application or not?
You could move the data into another application. So it's definitely only an end user solution that I painted there. So you need one of the other tools that Simon talked about in his presentation to utilize the other aspects of your supply chain management solution. So this data could be exported through GPRS if your phone had internet connectivity. Otherwise, it could be transported via USB to your computer or onto flash memory.
Flash memory. Thanks.
Just a quick question, technically. I remember many years ago I was writing everything in Visual Basic, and then we discovered .NET, and suddenly everything happened at triple speed. And I was curious, you know, I heard about this project to port the Rapid SMS server to Android, and then suddenly here it is, and it's gorgeous. What has your experience been working on that platform? You know, how's it working there versus doing more traditional mobile development?
It's a newer open source community, so some of the documentation compared to other more mature platforms is not there. I imagine the Apple SDK for the iPhone is a little bit more documented. But our programming team, Daniel in particular, along with the UNICEF guys and Chris and Erica, were able to put this together in 4 weeks. So that it can't be that hard if you can do it that quickly. So it's good enough.
And how many developers on the team?
There's one here and one on the UNICEF team helping with.
I have a quick question for Paul. So when you show that graphics is actually very scary, so for field workers, they have probably a dozen forms that need to fill out. So is there an initiative to try to standardize the reporting process or a common platform, if you will?
There are initiatives, and bearing in mind that in terms of what you've seen there with something like the health reporting system, this is generally in the hands of the national health authorities. And in what we're seeing in a number of countries is that there is now a growing awareness that this kind of silo effect in terms of products being put into different reporting formats to report back to who's providing the products, that this is actually causing this kind of problems. But then actually now going through to try and undertake that reform throughout the whole health system, I mean, you're talking about quite substantial work. We have been sort of involved in Ethiopia and Madagascar to try and assist ministries of health in particular to address this. But again, you're dealing with something with so many different players involved that bringing all these people together on the table to try and create a solution, it requires the political motivation of the national authority and plus the financial means and the expertise to be able to redesign a whole distribution system. In the case of Ethiopia, you're looking at them wanting to have distribution data coming from 1,400 health posts that they just created. And it's quite an effort. So there is this awareness being built, but I think it's going to take a lot of work to be able to improve. I think also Zambia has just started. And actually, I saw a slide that the Zambia Minister of Health put together. I saw that last week, and they'd used that same format that Steve designed to also to highlight the mess they're in.
I just want to publicly say kudos to Damagi and the UNICEF team. I think this might be the first cell phone-based gateway we can actually aggregate data and also the client for entering data. So I think that's very notable. So congratulations again. And it's pretty significant. It's really a first hybrid of this type, and we're super stoked to buy 14 phones and send them out. So thank you, guys.
Hey, John,
can you open up your later? It's all UNICEF's idea, so it's they're thinking.
A quick question on the emergency workshop. I kind of understand sort of what the other two are going to talk about, but I was in the process of going to talk to someone else, but I didn't quite understand like what's happening in the emergency workshop, or I mean breakout.
I thought you designed it.
No, oh, this is where we've been going.
No, what we're going to do, at least in the three concepts that we just dreamt up, one of them would be sort of on rapid assessment, which is it's something I don't think has been covered in the way that we're looking at it. So rapid assessment by sort of skilled monitors. The other one would be more on situation analysis, particularly logistics situation analysis. That's bridge status, road status, security incidents, etc. And then the third one would be needs assessment through directly from the community, as we've seen in some of the examples earlier today. So it was sort of on those three streams.
Thank you.
I just have another sort of follow-on question. Are there plans, or have you guys built out some of the rules engine on the back end so that, like, if you hit certain thresholds of supply depletion, then it would automatically sort of give an alert and or initiate some action that came on afterwards?
That's definitely a next step that is easy to program, but that people such as Paul Simon and everybody else in this room who's a field person has to help inform. And there's a limit to how much you can do through an interface that says, well, through any interface, but specifically one that's like the Android interface. And so it will certainly be capable of running things like that. And I think automated reports and automated alert generation is one of the best uses of SMS field collection technology for supply chain management. So that definitely will be added. And it's a question of how much can you do in a user interface that's customizable in the field, because we really don't want to have to program this on a computer and then download it, because one of the keys is that anybody in the field can do this. So all 10 of EP sites can have different people playing with it in different ways.
Sort of what our plans are for rapid SMS in the coming couple months. I mean, obviously, so this Android thing, I mean, we wanted to show it here, but it really was so only 4 weeks in the making and two developers and then Jonathan and then Chris and I sort of talking on a regular basis. I mean, so the rapid SMS, the version that's on Android is sort of our most flexible version. You can sort of create a form and it's really meant for other people to go and take and use. If we were, but we could very easily sort of limit it and start writing rules into it in the same way that the system that we have going in Ethiopia or Malawi has rules in it. So if people start entering data that was wildly inaccurate, for example, it would, you know, write them back and say, are you sure? Or, you know, I think you need to check again. So it really can be programmed sort of as tightly as you want or as loosely as you want. And I think sort of our challenges over the sort of the coming couple months is to look at what are the core things that UNICEF's doing. I mean, supply seems incredibly, you know, a really good choice. But then looking at the other sector, you know, I mean, looking at monitoring of, let's say, nutrition. Do we have a nutrition version of rapid SMS? And I know that our developers, Mark, Evan, Merrick, and Adam, and then sort of with us, are really trying to sort of put our heads around what this means as a system, you know, for UNICEF and others in the coming months. So it's just become more and more useful in that way.
Okay, if nothing else, then I guess we take the coffee break now if it's ready. And then if I could ask you to come back, what is the coffee break, 15 minutes? 15 minutes, if you can come back here and then sort of just gravitate towards the workshop that you're, or the breakout that you're interested in, and we'll all sort of, we'll set up in four different corners of the room, and if teams need to go outside somewhere else, they can go outside. We scheduled a sort of an hour and a half for the breakout, but that's going to include the time for getting everyone together, having your discussions, and then feeding back and then coming back for the wrap up. So we break now, and then 3:10, if we can all come back here and start with the breakouts. Thanks very much. Nice.